The Orions. For a race that is so well integrated into Star Trek lore, there is so little information known about them. This video will mostly concentrate on the TOS information regarding this mysterious species. The subject of the Orion slave women is one of the most interesting, but also one of the more sketchy issues, so it'll be saved for last. The first episode to look at will be Journey to Babel. This episode is interesting because it's the first time we see Orions in a political light. It is rather ambiguous if they are a Federation member, as they do not appear to have a delegate aboard the ship, but we cannot be sure that all Federation members are aboard. While some planets may have a strong opinion as to the admission of the Quarter planets to the Federation, some Federation members may not have any interest in the subject. One thing assumed from this episode is the idea of Orion neutrality. The idea that the Orions have some attempt to appear neutral in space affairs, but the episode really just suggests that the destruction of the Enterprise may have caused an internal Federation civil war. The Orions would be neutral in that conflict, selling stolen Koron crystals to both sides.
I think you'll find he's an Orion, Doctor.
Orion?
Intelligence reports that Orion smugglers have been raiding the Koron system.
But what would they gain by an attack on Starfleet?
Mutual suspicion. And interplanetary war.
Yes, of course, with Orion carefully neutral, they'd clean up by supplying dilithium to both sides and continue to raid Corinth.
It should be noted that this may not be an act of the Orion government, if such thing exists. Spock did credit to Orion smugglers and not a government.
Intelligence reports that Orion smugglers have been raiding the Koron system.
Although the government can use smugglers to achieve their own gain, it just puts doubt on the question if this was caused by an Orion government. One thing made clear in this episode was that the Federation members have differing opinions regarding the admission of the Koron system to the Federation. Some very opposed to the admission, while others wish it to be admitted to the Federation. Those are the lines that would have fractured the Federation if the Enterprise had been destroyed, both sides accusing the other of the destruction of the Enterprise. I believe I'm the first to pull out that they were talking about a Federation civil war in this episode.
Mutual suspicion. And interplanetary war.
Yes, of course, with Orion carefully neutral, they'd clean up by supplying dilithium to both sides.
I really should do a video on the structure of the Federation, because it does appear to be more than a UN in space, but not as far as the United States in space. Also, we learn that they have access to Tri-Titanium in the building of their ships.
I can sense our readings of Tri-Titanium from the alien ship's hull.
Memory Alpha mistakenly accredits this to the reason they could not scan the intruder ship. But Spock is clear that he does not know why, attributing it to either the hull density or deliberate cloaking from scans.
The ship's hull seems to have a high density level or is cloaked against sensor probes. It is manned, but sensors cannot make out specifics.
We also meet Thalov, who turns out to be an Orion spy, but since he is pretending to be an Andorian, we can't really get much out of him. Another episode to take a look at is What a Little Girl's Made Of, where we learn that Dr. Corby's translation of Orion's ruins revolutionized immunization treatments.
Now, Dr. Corby, often called the Pasteur of Archaeological Medicine, his translation of medical records from the Orion ruins revolutionized our immunization techniques.
This does mean we have access to ancient Orion sites. And even though the Federation likely knows the Orion language, since these are older sites, translations would be a bit trickier as languages do change over time. Next, we have the awesome Marta, from whom gods destroy, the second and last real Orion we have to look at. And she is not pretending to be from a different planet. There is very little we can live from her. There is the dance, which reminds Spock of the dances children of Vulcan used to do, but better coordinated.
What is your reaction, Mr. Spock?
Well, I find it mildly interesting and somewhat nostalgic, if I understand the use of that word.
Nostalgic?
Yes, it is somewhat reminiscent of the dances that Vulcan children do in nursery school. Of course, the children are not so well-coordinated.
With Marta's proven ability to come up with poems from Earth on her own.
Shall I compare thee to a summer's day? Thou art more lovely and more temperate. Rough winds do shake the darling buds of May, and summer's lease hath all...
You wrote that?
Yesterday, as a matter of fact.
It was written by an earthman named Shakespeare a long time ago.
Which does not alter the fact that I wrote it again yesterday. I think it's one of my best poems, don't you?
We cannot be sure if the dance is Orion in nature, even if dancing may be a huge Orion cultural influence. Then we have her attempt to kill Kirk.
For assuring permanent male fidelity.
But the idea that she would kill a mate, especially before copulation, could not be culturally derived. The episode would suggest that this was indeed part of a plot to get the password.
Mr. Scott, the captain's life is in immediate danger. Beam him aboard at once. The security team will be entrusted to me.
Queen to Queens level 3. Repeat. Queen to Queens level 3.
Waiting for the proper reply, Captain.
Give the countersign as ordered.
Scotty, Mr. Spock will give the countersign.
Give him the countersign, Captain.
Security detail, stand by to beam down.
Garth also described her as...
Now, it is true that she is deadly as a poisonous serpent.
Which could just be speaking of her personality and not Orion women as a whole. But then again, Garth is crazy, so it's hard to know for sure if even that is true. Next, we have the final TOS reference, and that is the cage. But before we get into that, we need to speak of stereotypes. People usually know of stereotypes as a bad thing, but really they are just shorthand people use to define things that are new to them. Sometimes they are true in a cultural perspective. Real offense comes from using them as a definition of a culture without any deeper understanding to be learned, or if they are used as a form of cultural assassination. An example of cultural assassination would be saying things like all black people are criminals or Jewish people are greedy money grubbers. This channel does not agree with those ideas. One also has to understand that they do not necessarily apply to individuals. One example of such a stereotype is the idea that all black people love fried chicken. This comes from the fact that fried chicken is a staple of what is known as soul food that has African American roots and formed mostly amongst Southern African American families. That does not mean that all black people like it or that all black people have any cultural identification with soul food. Everything we speak of from this point on has to be taken with acrimony and salt. Everything comes from the mind of humans. We can trust the Federation not to be racist, so on some levels, these ideas may be true. But by no means tells us if it's true for the whole culture, and that some ideas may be misunderstood. Let's start with Pike and the Doctor talking about the Orions.
Into business on regulars or in the Orion colony.
You, an Orion trader dealing in green animal women slaves?
Does that seem a little weird to anyone? We learn of the Orion slave trade, green animal women. Not only is Pike a Federation captain entertaining such an idea, but the Doctor dismisses it not in the "Are you crazy? Slavery?" The objection sounds more like, "You, a slave trader? You're not that type." Here, listen to the line again, and imagine your friend talking about dealing in slavery as we know it on Earth.
I'd go into business on regulars or in the Orion colony.
You, an Orion trader dealing in green animal women slaves?
Would you respond the same way Dr. Boyce did? Now, wait a minute. Didn't he also call them animal women? There has to be something more going on here. Listen to this line from Pike's Illusion.
Actually like being taken advantage nature.
Likes being taken advantage of. The most general definition of taking advantage of someone that I could find is to use a situation or opportunity to get what you want. The source is linked below. The only way I could see the Federation thinking this was not a big deal is if this was somehow voluntary slavery. That is, there is a widely accepted sub-dom fetish amongst Orion women. Not necessarily all Orion women either. There is also this idea that Orions are very sexually liberated. Well, that's all I can get from the original series on the Orion culture. I would be interested in going into other sources. I believe most of them are from Star Trek Enterprise, but currently I don't have access to those resources. But when my channel gets more popular, maybe I will get into that. I know this is just Pike's imagination, but has anyone else noticed that Vina is the only Orion in this scene?
Nice place you have here, Mr. Pike.